Good afternoon. Welcome to the Stanford Geriatric Education Center webinar series on dementia evaluation and management of diverse older adults and their families. I am Alain McBride, Associate Director Emerita at SGEC and Coordinator of the Preparedness Program. This webinar is co-sponsored with SGEC by the AGS, the California AHEC, and the Community Health Partnership. Three webinars are provided by the Geriatric Emergency Preparedness and Response Collaborative that focus on aspects of emergency preparedness for older adults with dementia. Our session is about community sheltering for persons with Alzheimer's disease and other memory disorders. Renee Chase and Janine Brown are highly experienced experts in this area. Arleen Johnson and Betty Shiels will join Renee and Janine at the live session to respond to your questions. As you go through the content, write your questions, then type them in the chat box during the live session. We are required to disclose that we do not have financial interest in products or on materials used for this training. Today, we will focus on the functional needs of persons with Alzheimer's disease in a disaster situation, shelter management, and preparedness resources. The next slides are background information and the presenters. I'll briefly introduce them, and you can go to these slides later for more information. Renee Chase is a community outreach coordinator for the Alzheimer's Association of Kentucky and Southern Indiana. Janine Brown is the senior director for the Louisville Area American Red Cross chapter in Kentucky. Arleen Johnson is the director of the OVER-GEC, a consortium of four universities. Betty Shiels is OVER-GEC Institutional Director at the University of Louisville. This next slide I'll skip. The collaborative consists of six HRSA-funded GECs. They received supplemental funds in 2004 to initiate geriatric preparedness training, and HRSA funds were released in response to the statement on the urgent need for aging and preparedness training of health providers developed by the National Association of GECs. It was presented to HRSA after the September 11 airplane crashes and the devastation of three successive hurricanes, the worst of which was Katrina. Several years of investigation and research on preparedness that added more experience with disasters produced federal reports. One significant conclusion is that the most vulnerable populations are often the ones who have unmet needs in all phases of a disaster. Ethnic elders with dementia and persons from diverse communities are among the vulnerable populations due to gaps in research on culturally proficient methods to strengthen their coping and recovery. The collaborative continues to offer preparedness trainings in various ways. One approach is the formation of three collaborative members into a national consortium to provide 12 preparedness webinars over 5 years. OVER-GEC organized this fifth of the 12 webinars. Renee, our first speaker, will talk about disaster preparedness and dementia. And here's Renee.
Hi, my name is Renee Chase, and I'm the Community Outreach Coordinator for the Greater Kentucky and Southern Indiana Chapter of the Alzheimer's Association. I'm here today to share with you some information about how to care for people with dementia in emergency shelter situations. Hopefully, as you go through this program or as you go through this presentation, You'll take a look at the polling questions ahead of time and think about them as you go through or as you follow through the rest of my presentation. Here are the first two questions and the third and fourth. I'll let you look through those on your own. But there is a link here that I would like for you to go to, and that will take you to where you can answer the polling questions. And if you could, it'd be great if you could do that ahead of time so that we can have that information with us when you join us for the live seminar. So without further ado, we're going to go ahead and get started. One of the questions that we often deal with is, how do you get someone into a shelter quickly and get them settled in? If you've got someone who's cognitively intact, it's not really a big issue. You do your intake, you assign them a place, or get them to where they need to be within the shelter. However, you will have people in your community who have Alzheimer's disease or some other form of dementia that come into the shelter alone. Best case scenario is that that person is going to have a caregiver with them. But, you know, there are 5.4 million people in the U.S. with Alzheimer's disease or some other kind of dementia. And of those 5.4 million, 70% live in the community still. And of those 70%, many of them live alone and do not have family nearby. So these folks eventually are going to end up with you. If you haven't seen one yet, you will. Just give it time. Now, after Katrina, especially after the shelter situation in the Houston Astrodome, there were a couple of different assessment tools that were developed by people who were actually in the care teams in the Houston Astrodome, and then also people from the Red Cross. Here are links to two of those tools that were used. They're kind of quick and dirty tools. They take 5-10 minutes, depending on the ability of the person to answer the questions. They are great for getting a picture of what a person is able to do cognitively. Now, both of these assessments cover a lot of other areas. They cover stuff about medication and people who may be medically frail or have underlying medical issues. But there are also sections on both of them that deal with cognitive issues as well. And to add to that, here are some orientation questions that are often used by physicians in order to do a quick check also of people who may have cognitive issues. You see the questions there, they're looking for the current month and year. Someone who's really disoriented because of the chaos of moving out of their home and into a shelter may have trouble answering something as specific as what time of day is it exactly. They may have trouble giving you the exact day, you know, saying it's April 11th, which, you know, today is, but maybe not when you're watching this. But they should be able to tell you the month and year. They should be able to tell you, if not the name, specific name of, okay, we're in the Houston Astrodome, they should be able to say we're in a football stadium. They should be able to say I'm in Houston, Texas. They should be able to say President Obama's the president. If they say Jimmy Carter, you might want to check on that. But and they should be able to tell you it's morning, it's afternoon, it's evening, even if they can't give you the specific time of day, because folks who have dementia are not going to be as oriented to kind of those larger blocks of what time of day it is. One thing to think about, though, is that if someone has an underlying medical condition, like an infection, or their medications are messed up, or they haven't had their medications, they may struggle with some of these questions. So you need to make sure that if they don't do well with these questions, they need a medical follow-up. So it's really important to have those kinds of people on your team so that they can do a more in-depth assessment to determine whether the person is having cognitive issues such as with dementia, or if they have a UTI, or if they're having medication interactions, or if they've got a high or low blood sugar, different situations like that. So, you find someone who has dementia, and what do you do with them now? FEMA guidelines say that shelter operators, as you can see here, are supposed to provide support services to accommodate people with disabilities. This is all part of kind of the ADA piece. So, as long as someone can function in a shelter without being medically fragile, they are entitled to be in that least restrictive environment and to stay in a general population shelter, but they also need to be in there with someone who can help them with some of their daily living activities and some of the minor assistance things they need. Now, whenever they start talking about daily activities of living or activities of daily living, what we're talking about here is it could be something as much as toileting someone, helping them with ambulation, things that you might see a CNA do. But as long as they can function in that general population, then they are entitled to stay there. Whenever someone needs more intense medical care, then you'll find them find that they can be moved over to the special needs shelters. And this assistance for these activities of daily living and medication, feeding, things like that, that is expected to be provided by either medical people or trained volunteers. And in a lot of the smaller community shelters, you're going to be depending on trained volunteers for that. So within the shelters, and whenever you do have someone who needs to have care because they have dementia, there is an allowance or there's a provision for personal assistance services so that those people can be with that person who has dementia and provide oversight and care for them. Because you may have someone who cognitively, they're so-so, kind of maybe on the borderline, but if you've got some, and they can function fairly well on their own, but if you've got someone who has trouble moving from place to place because of ambulation issues, maybe they have forgotten how to eat, then they're going to need an assistant to help them accomplish those things that they need to do for daily living. So it's important to have someone there in place and to make sure that they are trained in how to care for and how to interact with someone who has dementia. That may be something that's easy to do in some communities. It may be more difficult in others. This is where it's important to get to know other agencies in your community, to form relationships with home health agencies, with medical clinics, with anyone who has experience in caring for someone who has Alzheimer's disease or any other kind of dementia. Most non-medical home health agencies, and they're generally for-profit, they do have some degree of dementia training for a lot of their staff. I know that here in Lexington, Kentucky, I've done a lot of training with the home care agencies in this area so that their people are trained in how to care for folks that have dementia. Now, whenever you do have someone with Alzheimer's disease or another kind of dementia in your shelter, you need a higher ratio of better ratio of volunteers to the people with dementia. One volunteer to one or two people is the way to go. I know that it's very labor intensive that way, but that's how you're going to keep the person safe. If you've got a really skilled volunteer who really knows what they're doing, you might be able to put two, possibly even three, depending on the level of the person with dementia's functioning, with that one volunteer. But if you've got a volunteer who maybe is not as experienced, or they're dealing with a person who has a lot of difficulties functioning, then it's going to have to be a one-on-one. And this is why it's good to get to know those people in those home care agencies, because they will be able to help identify more people than you might find on your own or just simply using your usual avenues to recruit volunteers. FEMA provides some operational tools for training on personal assistance services. This is not only for people who have dementia, it's also for training for them to care for anyone who has medical issues or who needs assistance with those activities of daily living. FEMA suggests that most of those frontline personal assistance service volunteers come from community-based organizations. That could be, once again, those home care agencies, it could be churches, it could be your area development districts. You have one in every state in the union. You can contact that local area development district, and within each of those, there's an area agency on aging. And they will have access to people who might be able to help you develop those volunteers. Also, a lot of the health departments have home care services, and those people would be able to help you out as well. Now, if you get yourself into a situation and you find that you don't have enough volunteers, FEMA MassCare holds contracts with Dynamic Service Solutions, Inc. and ResCare, and they can provide additional personal assistance if there are volunteer shortfalls. However, the state has to be the one to request those additional volunteers, and they can only do that if there has been a presidential declaration of an emergency or disaster situation. So there has to be a presidential declaration. The state has to request the volunteers, And then if it is approved by FEMA, then they scramble out and can be at your facility within, I believe, 24 to 48 hours. There are a lot of resources listed, especially online resources, at the end of this presentation that'll have the specifics about that. Now we kind of get to the meat of it, and we're going to look at what impact disaster has on a person with dementia. Now, people with dementia, they often have difficulty adjusting to changes in routine under the most normal, perfect days. And so whenever they find themselves in a situation where they're being forcibly or being removed from their home because of an emergency evacuation, they're going to be much more sensitive to what's going on around them. They're very sensitive to trauma, and not only their own experience, but they pick up on the trauma that's going on and the activity level and that whole energy around them. People with dementia are very sensitive to what's happening with the people in their environment. So that's something to really watch out for. They also have a limited ability to understand directions and explanations. So when you're caring for someone, or whenever you have a group of people and you're trying to give instruction, hopefully those people that you've assessed as having some cognitive issues can be pulled out, because they're not going to be able to follow multiple piece instructions. Like if you were to say to someone, okay, I need all of you to go over here and get in line and sign these forms and do the intake, and then after that you can get your supplies and go and find a bed and settle yourselves in. Someone with dementia cannot follow all of that. You have to give them information one piece at a time. And even the speed that I'm speaking at right now is too fast for someone who's beyond the early stages of the disease. So if you have someone that maybe they've slipped through the assessment, but you see the deer in the headlights or kind of that 1,000-yard stare with them, then pull them aside and you're gonna have to slow down and speak more carefully so that they have time to absorb what it is you're saying. And even if you do that, they may forget what you told them. Because remember that Alzheimer's disease and a lot of other dementias are initially about short-term memory loss. There are a lot of other things that come along with it, but that short-term memory is usually the first thing to be damaged. So they're gonna forget instructions, and you're gonna have to repeat yourself. It's not very fun, and sometimes it's frustrating. But it's better in the long run to do that than to end up with someone who's agitated, frustrated, overwhelmed, and then begins to present some behaviors that are just not very helpful in that setting. Also, you're going to find that because people are fearful, they're going to start to try to wander or to hide. And you'd be surprised how small a space someone can get themselves into when they're frightened. So if you've got someone who comes in and it's very obvious that they have dementia, it's very obvious that they're agitated, put a volunteer with them one-on-one to comfort them, because otherwise they're going to get lost in the shuffle physically and you might not be able to find them. So you need to make sure that you've got someone with them. This is a really traumatic period for anybody, but for someone who has limited abilities to comprehend and to cope with these kinds of situations, it's difficulty times 10. Now, remember, like I said, don't leave them alone. And those changes in the routine and environment, they're gonna possibly be agitated. They're gonna try to wander. You may see people have more hallucinations or delusions. They may have more sleep disturbances because they're out of their regular environment. Someone who is in their home and is functioning on a normal and, you know, just kind of on their regular daily routine, they do well, or as well as they can, with this disease. But when you pull them out into a totally new situation, the disorientation is overwhelming. So always try to be sensitive to the fact that it's like if you were to end up somewhere in Eastern Europe and you don't speak the language and you don't understand the culture, you would be at a total loss. You would either get angry and start yelling, or you may withdraw. So that's kind of how it feels for them. So just keep that in mind whenever you're setting up and identifying and beginning to work with folks. Now, effective care. This is really important because the key here is to manage not only them, but to also manage yourself. There's a lot of, probably my guess is there's a lot of excitement, there's a lot of energy, there's a lot of multitasking and stuff going on in a shelter setting. So when you are working with, or your volunteers are working with someone who has dementia, slow yourself down first. That's very, very important, because what you do is what they're going to do. That person is going to take their cues from you. So it's important that you manage yourself and that you kind of clear your mind and slow down and really focus on what's going on within and with them. You need to approach them from the front, use his or her name, and approach more slowly. And part of the reason why is because since they process more slowly, if you walk up at a normal pace or a brisk pace, it's going to, for them, it feels like you're running at them. And so they may withdraw or flinch or pull back. So you need to slow down. Use calm, positive statements. Be patient. Another thing is a lot of people who have dementia, or actually just a lot of older people anyway, as their hearing begins to deteriorate, they lose the ability to hear the higher registers. So if you've got a higher voice, pitch your voice lower, and they're able to hear it better. But also, a lot of times that lower pitched voice, especially for older folks, it has more of a ring of authority with it. So it's not just about the physical ability to hear, it's also about the psychological piece of how people respond to lower voices. So also be reassuring, let them know you're in the right place. It's gonna be okay, I am here with you. Respond to their emotions rather than the content of the words. If they keep saying, I wanna go home, well, you know, everybody wants to go home. But don't tell them, no, you can't go home, it's not safe. Instead, say something more along the lines of, I'm quite sure this is very frightening for you, but let's stay here for a while, and you can come and help me do such and such task. That's how you divert their attention. So you address the fear, you address the concern, you're safe, it's okay here. We're gonna stay here for a while because it's safer than being anywhere else. And that helps them, instead of getting into a confrontational situation where you argue with them, don't argue, it doesn't work. Instead, you're coming alongside them and saying, okay, we've got this difficult situation, but we're gonna work on it together. You know, it's not safe outside right now, or it's not safe in your neighborhood right now. So we're going to stay here and we're gonna make sure that everything's okay. So don't argue with them, try to divert that attention. Also, avoid elaborate or detailed explanations. Like I said, they can only take one chunk of information at a time. So if you have to get someone to do several different things, or you want them to do several different things, one thing at a time and go slow. You really need to be observant about what's going on with them. Whenever you are giving instructions or giving explanations, you'll see them, they may be nodding their head, but you can tell they're not getting it. So that's when you slow down. But just give very brief, simple explanations. Also, there it says be prepared to provide additional assistance with activities of daily living. That's where that personal assistance comes in. But also, pay attention to the cues that this person may be overwhelmed. One of the things about communication with someone who has Alzheimer's disease is they begin to use nonverbal communication more and more as their verbal skills deteriorate. So they may not be able to tell you, I'm really scared, or I'm really worried, or I'm very frustrated or agitated. So you may see them messing with stuff, or you may see them pacing around, or you may see them going and walking and touching everything, or, you know, doing physical things that show that they're having trouble coping with the environment. So you want to make sure that you're paying attention to what's going on with them. Now, some things that I would suggest that you have on hand in such situations, because I call it the bag of tricks, and we'll get to that in just a second. But a bag of tricks can address a lot of these issues. It can find the outlets for the anxious energy. It can help you redirect. When you do see someone who's agitated, move them to a quieter place, limit stimulation, make sure they're taking their medications as scheduled, because a lot of times when people with dementia don't get their meds, then you're gonna see more unpredictable behaviors take place. And then you also want to try to keep them on a regular schedule, because that will mitigate, hopefully alleviate, any of those behavioral difficulties that you see. Now, back to the bag of tricks. One of the things that we do is we encourage people to have a tub full of stuff. And that stuff can be, ours has vinyl LPs in it. We've got a Guy Lombardo album. We've got an old Elvis album. We've got the Pointer Sisters, or the Andrews Sisters, sorry. We also have binders full of photographs of movie stars and famous people from the 30s and 40s and 50s. And the reason why you want to have stuff that's older is because it's more easily relatable for that person who has dementia. That person would be able to look at a picture of Rita Hayworth and go, oh, I remember her. She was so beautiful. I had such a crush on her. And then they'll tell you stories, and it helps divert them from some of that anxiety that they may be experiencing because of their environment that they're currently in. So use things that take them back to good memories. If you don't have a subscription to Reminisce magazine, get one. Go online and take a look at it. I know I normally don't endorse things, but it's a terrific magazine just simply because it's completely built on stories and events and positive things from the past. And it's a terrific jumping off point for conversation, because the more you can get someone to tell their story, the more you're going to find that they can calm down. And it may be, even if you can't get someone to sit down and look at a binder of pictures with you, get them to help you sort whatever it is, or fold towels, or do whatever tasks there are in the shelter. And as you do that, you can talk about, wow, I remember when I was a kid and my mom would set an entire basket of towels in front of me to fold, and I thought it was horrible, but it was really only about 10 towels. And then your person may start talking about, yeah, I remember when we used to wash clothes in a kettle out in the backyard. And so you use all of these things to help a person tell their story and be more comfortable. And that's one of the key things, is nobody, you know, everybody likes to talk. Well, maybe not everybody, but we all like to tell our stories. And we like to tell our stories to people who are willing to listen. And that is one of the key pieces that you can use, and it doesn't take a lot of work to get someone to tell you their story. Now, when you do see some of these unexpected behaviors, when you see someone being aggressive, here's some specific things you can do. Try to move them away from the trigger. And the trigger could be another person that they're near. It could be loud noises, if there's a television, if there's kids. It could be shadowy places where maybe they think there's someone hiding and is going to jump out and get them. Whenever you see, look and see, what is it that's causing them to feel this way? Well, either move them away from it, like if it's a dark, shadowy place, or remove the trigger from the person's vicinity. Maybe it's the telephone and they think they've got to call home. Drop a towel or something over it so they don't notice it anymore. You can also use soothing music. That's another piece of your bag of tricks. Get a CD player or whatever it is, if you've got an iPod and speakers. Put some music on there that's soothing from the 30s and 40s and 50s, and play it for them. Music is such a touch point for all people, but for someone who has dementia, it's a very important one, because that's something that they're able to relate to no matter what stage they're in with the disease. So music will help soothe the aggression. It'll also help with the anxiety and the agitation. You can engage them around story. You can use the music. Anything that's going to help kind of move them off of, when can I go home? When can I go home? When can I go home? Another thing with confusion, and you're going to have confusion, respond with some very brief, very clear explanations. We're here in the shelter because right now it's not safe to go home. And sometimes, a lot of times people are going to understand there's ice out there and the electricity is out, so we're going to stay here where it's warm and clean and dry. Or if it's a flooding situation, we're going to stay here so that we can stay dry and we don't have to get out in the rain. And they can pretty much get that. But sometimes they'll be confused for other reasons. They may not really realize what time of day it is. They may have trouble understanding where they are. They may even be confused to the point to where they don't even fully, they're not even oriented to the decade they're in. And that happens. They may think that it's something that happened 40 years ago, and they may think they're in church, or they may think they're at a fair or whatever. And one of the things about confusion is that you can, actually there's a couple of things you can do. One is you can use that bag of tricks, the photos, the pictures, and other things to get stories out of them. Now, if you've got someone who's confused and they think that they're in a happy place, you know, if they're in the Houston Astrodome, oh my gosh, we're at the State Fair, go with it. And that may sound kind of strange, but if someone is having a delusion that they're somewhere else and it's not harmful and it's not going to hurt them and it's not going to hurt anyone else, don't tell them, no, you're not at the State Fair, you're in the Houston Astrodome. Don't do that. Just go with it. We're at the State Fair. Wow, that's awesome. Let's go see what we can see. Have you ever been on a Ferris wheel? That is really amazing. I remember the first time I went. Have you ever done that? And then you can get back to the stories. More behaviors. Repetition. You can turn the action. And repetition, often this is a lot of times physical repetition. You might see someone who sits and just smooths out their skirt or their pants or their shirt, or maybe they're picking at things or they're shuffling papers. And part of that is born out of old actions and old behaviors. But you can take that repetition and you can use it and turn it into an activity. Maybe you do need some paper shuffled, or you can give them papers that really aren't all that important and let them shuffle them all they want. Or you can get them to help you, you know, if you're sorting out things for mealtime, get them to help you sort out stuff or to put stuff on the table or whatever. Give them something useful to do. Just because someone has dementia doesn't mean they don't want to be useful anymore or that they can't be useful anymore. We all like to feel like we're contributing. And if you can tap into that need to feel like they're contributing, then you're actually helping alleviate a lot of that anxiety and they feel like they're doing something important. If the repetition is about questions or statements, answer them every time they ask. And the reason why is because even if they're asking it every 2 minutes, they don't remember 2 minutes ago when they did ask it previously. So answer the question. It's frustrating for us, but they are doing the best they can. They really are. Their communication toolbox is pretty small. Ours is quite large, so we need to pull out all of our tools and use them and do most of the work because they're doing the best they can, and we need to give them our best. However, whenever you've got that person asking the same question over and over again, you can write it on a big piece of paper in big block letters and put it in a prominent place, and whenever they keep asking, just say, well, here's the answer. Like if they are saying, you know, where's my daughter? Maybe it's somebody whose daughter has been with them, but the daughter still has to go work or take care of the, you know, watch out for the home or do whatever during the day. So you've got Mrs. Smith by yourself. Then you can put a big piece of paper in front of her and say, your daughter will return when we have supper. You can't say the daughter will return at 5 o'clock because she may not have that concept of time. But she can see when supper's coming, and she'll know that whenever supper is arriving, then her daughter will arrive also. And you can just keep referring it to her. But don't ever say, well, look, don't you remember? Well, they wouldn't ask the question if they did. So try not to say that. You're also going to run into people who are suspicious. Remain non-defensive, and they may be suspicious of you or of others around them. And remember, this is not a personality trait where they want to be this way. This is because of the disease. All of these behaviors are because they have a disease. So stay non-defensive, even if they accuse you of stealing something. Don't argue with them. Allow them to express themselves and then engage them. You can ask them to help you with a task. You can engage them in an activity. But this is the point to where you really do want to try to divert their attention. If they're suspicious, say they're accusing someone of having stolen their purse. You stole my purse. Wow, you know what? I don't remember having seen it in a while, and it may be that perhaps I moved it whenever I was cleaning your area. Let's go see if we can find it. And so what happens is you align yourself with the person to solve the problem together rather than saying, no, I didn't do it. You must have put it somewhere. You know, and if you have to, even get a tub or a box or something and let them put all their stuff in it, place it where they want it, or let them place it where they want it, and then keep referring back to it frequently so that they know that there's that tub, it has my stuff in it, it's okay. Another thing, you're going to have people who try to leave because it's going to be chaotic at times. Make sure all the volunteers know the person has dementia. Keep them active. Keep them engaged. That's where you can use more of the daily tasks. You can use the activities, music. If you do have a television, hey, pop in a Jack Benny show or a Lawrence Welk or something like that, and they'll sit and watch it quite often. Make sure you don't have a gigantic big screen TV, because to them that may seem like real life. You want to have a smaller TV, just an aside there for you. Now, something also to know about is that there's a bracelet called Medic Alert Safe Return. Here it is in the picture. If a person shows up in your shelter and they have this on, if you look at the second picture there, it has a ID number and an 800 number. Call the 800 number if the person is alone. You report this person's ID number on to the person who answers the number in their response center, and they will contact the family of that person and let the family know where he or she is. That's very, very important. This is something that first responders and police officers use all the time whenever people show up or whenever someone is found. Now, this is also helpful if you've got someone that has this bracelet and they're in your shelter and they wander off. Call 911, report that the person is missing, give the ID number, and then that way they'll set out a golden alert or a silver alert immediately and will know to be on the lookout for this person. These are tremendous things, especially in urban and suburban areas where someone is liable to be met or picked up by first responders or even Good Samaritans in the community. It doesn't work quite as well in the deeply rural areas because someone could wander off and nobody would find them. But it's a great thing to have if you're going into a shelter situation, because whenever you call that number and you give the ID number for someone who shows up alone, then that family is immediately contacted. And that family can give you information about the person you're caring for if they can't get to your person or to the shelter. It's very important. There is the thing about if you find, or if a citizen or emergency personnel finds the person with dementia, you call the number. These are not really expensive. You can get applications for them through any Alzheimer's Association chapter or online at alz.org. They are tremendous tools to help keep someone safe and to make sure that they are found and recovered back to their families much more quickly. Now, final thoughts. Sounds like Jerry Springer. Long before you find yourself trying to care for a person with dementia in a shelter, when you are deciding where you want your shelter to be and what you want it to look like, go to the community, include family caregivers in your planning process, collaborate with local dementia care professionals so that you can get input on medical issues and other things that are related to dementia and dementia care, and work with your local Alzheimer's Association chapter for resources and for training opportunities, because your chapters have people who can do training just like I'm doing right now. Only they can do it in person and you can ask them all the questions you want. So it's really important to plan on the front end. I'll tell you the same thing I tell my families whenever I do training with them, is if you don't plan on the front end, you're going to have a mess on the backside. So you want to make sure that you're proactive about everything you do related to dementia. Here are the resources. I will let you look through those on your own. They're all terrific. Most of them are online. So I hope that you have heard some things maybe that you needed to hear. I hope I haven't given you too much in a short period of time. There's my contact information, but I also encourage you that if you're not in the Kentucky area, that you call 1-800-272-3900 and you will be put into contact with someone from your local chapter who can give you some terrific information and a lot of good support. Thanks for your time, and I hope you all have a wonderful day.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for allowing me to speak today. I'm excited and honored to be a part of this webinar and to represent the American Red Cross. Today we'll be talking a little bit about the American Red Cross sheltering system and the community vision that we have for sheltering in times of a disaster. First thing we want to talk about is whose job is it? Is it the American Red Cross? Is it public health? Is it emergency management? It is actually everybody's job. It is the whole community that determines how quickly response and recovery will take place from a disaster. The American Red Cross may be the primary sheltering agent, but we cannot do it alone. Disaster relief organizations, county government, private sector businesses, and faith-based organizations are all a part of the sheltering system. And all disasters start locally and end locally, so it's incredibly important that we utilize all of our local resources to determine the best possible outcomes for the clients that we're serving. The mission of the American Red Cross is to prevent and alleviate human suffering in the face of emergencies by mobilizing the power of volunteers and the generosity of donors. I wanted to speak to this a little bit because it's often a misconception with the American Red Cross that we are a government-funded agency. We're not. We rely on the community to help us provide those services. We're not a line item on any government budget, so it's really critical that we bring the community in to what we do. And by doing that, we create a strong local presence to better serve our communities. We are a volunteer-led organization. 93% of the American Red Cross is made up of volunteers. When you think about that, that's an incredible number. And it also provides us the opportunity to be a good steward of the donated dollar by engaging our local volunteer resources. We are mandated by Congress to respond to disasters, but again, we're not government funded. So the Red Cross will always be there. It's what we need to do. It's the right thing to do. I wanted to speak a little bit on our response guidelines. The Red Cross response occurs in coordination and cooperation with emergency management, but we are mandated by Red Cross policy. We base it on our Red Cross principles and values and are vital to keeping commitments to our five constituent groups, our clients, our donors, our workers, our partners, and the public. And I wanted to elaborate a little bit on those. The commitment to our clients is to provide appropriate services quickly and efficiently based on their disaster cause needs. Now, when I say disaster cause needs, it varies. Everybody is different. Everybody's needs are different. So we evaluate those needs on a case-by-case basis. We know that sheltering is needed. We open shelters that will meet the needs or try to meet the needs of everybody in the community. And then every service beyond sheltering and feeding and health and medical needs are determined on a case-by-case basis based on damage and resources that each individual has. We want to be a good steward of the donated dollar. Again, that goes back to what I said before about engaging volunteers and local resources to have the most comprehensive response we can possibly have. And what about those volunteers and those Red Cross workers? Do we have a commitment to them? Absolutely we do. We have a commitment to support, lead, guide, or be led by volunteers and engage them in appropriate actions and to also take care of them during their disaster response. Our commitment to our partners is to provide accurate information, to share with them what the Red Cross is doing, what our needs are, and to share together our successes as a community. And also to the public, it is our commitment to provide information to the public in a timely manner about where Red Cross resources are, what we're doing, what services we are providing, and how we're going to provide those services to the public. So we have a sheltering cycle, and it starts with planning and preparedness. And in that phase, every Red Cross chapter across the United States are getting shelter agreements. They're training, and they're having conversations with our partners. When we look at a shelter agreement, we use community buildings, schools, churches, all kinds of different facilities, and we go in and we assess what those facilities can be used for during a disaster. Do they have enough bathroom facilities? Is there enough parking in the parking lot? Are there showers available? Are they handicap accessible? Do they meet all the guidelines that we need to have to provide a comprehensive sheltering situation? We then try our best to get the people who own the building, if it's a church or it's a school, to engage their staff and their volunteers and their community in operating that shelter, because we need their help. When we're in their building or in their facility, we want them to be an active part of that sheltering situation. So when we go to open the shelter, some of the things that we need to do is work with the people who have the ownership of the facility or care for the facility and do a complete walkthrough to make sure that everything is accounted for, that we know what areas of the building we can't use, what we can use. We take a look at are all of the entries accessible, what are the emergency exits. We make sure that we have everything lined up and ready to go before we open that door. And we want to make sure that each shelter is appropriate for the disaster into which we are responding. Is it in a safe area? Is it a chance that this area is going to flood in a week? We need to take all of those things into consideration, and that's when we work very, very closely with emergency management and our partners to determine the appropriate locations for a shelter. When we talk about organizing the shelter, again, we want to make sure that the shelter is set up appropriately. We have to look at all kinds of different things like dormitory management. We need to make sure that we have single adults separated, that families can stay together, that we have the appropriate facilities for children, all of those things that we have to take into consideration. Do we have private areas for health services and mental health services? Is it possible to use that facility to co-locate with public health should we have medical needs greater than what can be maintained in a general population setting? We look at those things all during the planning process, but we re-look at them again during opening, and we re-look at them again during organizing the shelter to ensure that we have the best possible outcomes, again, for the clients that we're serving. When we talk about operating the shelter, there are three things that we really think of in every aspect of sheltering, and that's respect. Respect is the first thing. We want to have respect for our clients, respect for our shelter workers, respect for the people that have generously allowed us to use their building. We want to make sure that we are doing the best possible job keeping everybody's expectations managed. When we talk about rules and routines, those are extremely important in the operation of a shelter. We need to have rules. No weapons, no drugs, no alcohol. Those, you would think those go without saying, but they need to be posted and they need to be adhered to. We need to have rules about pets. The Red Cross does take service animals in a shelter, but we do not accept just everybody's normal pet. They're, you know, I have pets myself, and you know, my pets can't come in the shelter, as much as that as painful as that is. But we are working with partners to ensure that we can take care of pets as well, just right outside the shelter setting. But that being said, there has to be rules and there has to be guidelines. Also with routines, it's important to have routines in the shelter to make sure that the meal times are the same every day, to make sure that showering schedules are given out so that people know what to expect. We want to make this as easy as possible on the clients that we're serving, and the way to do that is to establish great rules, great routines, and show that respect. And listen to the clients. If something isn't working, you know what? We can fix that. It's about listening and respecting what they're telling us. Not everything has to be written in stone, and not all shelters are the same. When we close the shelter, we make sure that everybody has a place to go. We're not closing shelters and putting people out on the streets. They've worked with our client caseworkers and our shelter managers to ensure that they have somewhere they need to go when the shelter, they can go when the shelter closes. We try very hard to make sure that it's a suitable situation for them. It's close in proximity to their children's schools. We really try to be advocates for our shelter clients and make sure that we have the best possible outcomes. As far as the building is concerned, the same walkthrough we do at the beginning, we do at the end. We want to make sure that we leave it exactly as we found it or in better condition than when we found it. We return all of the equipment to our partners, our vendors, to our Red Cross chapters, and we do that final walkthrough to make sure that we have, again, shown that respect for the people that generously allowed us to use their building. And then we work with the after-action review. We want to know what went well, what didn't go well. And we do this after every disaster because that's how we get better. is by looking at what we can improve on and what we need to do to make this a more suitable outcome. So sheltering considerations and questions that I think probably everybody has. Can everyone stay in a congregate shelter? Can we meet the diverse needs of everyone in the shelter? And we're talking not only their cultural needs, their dietary needs, health, mental health, and the needs of children. When is someone not suited to staying in a shelter situation, and how do we determine who stays and who does not? What I can tell you is the goal is to keep everybody we can in a general population shelter. We want to do this by talking to the clients and saying, what do we need to keep you here? How can we support you to stay in this environment for as long as it's needed? And by doing that, they can tell us, you know, I didn't get to bring my wheelchair, or I need a transfer board to get from the cot to the wheelchair. Whatever that happens to be, we want to talk to the clients to see really what is the best possible scenario and how did they do things at home. How can we make this more like this is going to be their home? So we want to make this as much like their home as we possibly can for the time that they have to be there. We want to make sure that we're keeping families together, married couples together, and ensuring that we have adequate resources for our children. Do they need a place to play? Do they need activities? What do we need to do to make everybody as comfortable as possible? When we say how do we determine who stays and who does not, or when someone is not suited to staying in a shelter, that is not a decision that is made in a vacuum. That is a decision that we make with our health services staff, our mental health staff, and the client. We need to visit with them and figure out what is the best possible case. If somebody is ill and has something that could be a communicable disease, are we going to keep them in the shelter? Probably not. But what is the best possible solution? That's where the community comes in. That's where our partners come in. Where is the best place for our clients to be that can meet their disaster cause needs? Can we meet the diverse needs of everybody in the shelter? Yes. Can we meet them immediately? Not in every case. But by speaking with the clients and providing the resources they need to communicate with us, we hope that that will be the ultimate outcome. So all of that being said, and I've said it several times, I believe, already, partnerships are critical. Before, during, and after the disaster, for all of the emergency support function, which is ESF6 activities, or ESF is emergency support function activities, 6 is mass care, such as sheltering, feeding, and bulk distribution. We could not open shelters without partnerships with our schools, churches, and our community. Emergency management also helps us gather resources that are critical to success of sheltering. Our health departments, our community agencies, such as areas on aging, our university partners, our food bank partners, Southern Baptists who do a lot of feeding during disasters, and our pet partners. This is really new for the American Red Cross. We're really trying to look at comprehensive sheltering situations and how we can get people's pets in close proximity to the shelters. Our goal is to create comprehensive sheltering situations where congregate needs can be met, medical needs can be met, and people can be close to their animals. Are we there yet everywhere in the country? No. Is it a goal? Absolutely. There is also a shelter field guide that is in process of being written with FEMA and the American Red Cross. It's not on the shelf yet, but that's also going to be a resource for communities who are thinking of opening their own shelters and what they could run into and the types of things that they need to look for in opening a shelter. Often, random shelters open out of necessity or out of the goodness of somebody's heart, and they don't have all the facts about what really needs to happen to make a shelter run smoothly. And so we're hoping to work with our partners and the community to ensure that everybody has good information should they not be a Red Cross shelter. I'm going to talk a little bit about health-related needs. We know that disaster-related injuries and or illnesses are obviously an option. There's exacerbation of chronic diseases, stress-related symptoms, functional and access need clients, and clients that need language translation and or medical interpreter needs. I keep harping on the partnership piece because not our volunteers are not all trained to deal with every type of emergency in a shelter. Most of our volunteers are not medically trained other than basic first aid and CPR, but they do know how to recognize emergencies. And so what we do is we have health services, disaster health services volunteers, and mental health volunteers that really work closely with our clients as we bring them into the shelter and ensure that through the Red Cross or community resources, we can meet the needs of everyone that is in a shelter situation. The next slide just gives you a view of what shelter life actually looks like in a large setting. As you can see, cots are spread out everywhere. Some people are on cots, some people are walking around. We try to make sure that we have cots that meet the needs of everybody, that the shelter will meet the needs. But I don't know if you can imagine sleeping with, 300 or 400 of your closest new best friends. But it is a stressful situation, and that is something that we often have to deal with, as well as obvious medical needs. So I want to talk a little bit about registration. What happens when you come to a shelter? Because I think this is critical in your planning process so that you can educate people that you are visiting with about sheltering. We have a reception area, typically, where people will come in. We can try to get them out of the weather. We have people that will offer them a bottle of water, greet them while they're getting ready to do registration. We also have a registration form, an initial intake and assessment tool, and shelter resident information process that we can go through. And then we make referrals as appropriate to them for other resources that can't be met in the shelter. But I want to talk a little bit about the tools that we use. The registration form is very standard as far as name, address, pre-disaster address, how many people are in your family, those types of things. But we also have the initial intake and assessment tool, which I think is being provided to you. This tool assesses individuals for functional and access needs. When they get into the shelter, the people at the registration desk will go through the first 9 questions. If a shelter resident answers yes to any of those questions for their family, it doesn't have to be the person answering the questions, but it could be any member of their family, then we're going to automatically refer them to health services or to mental health services so we can start having those conversations about what we need to do to keep them in that general population shelter. We found it's a very useful tool, and it's really helped us identify early on what types of needs that we're going to be seeing in our shelter so that we can gather the appropriate resources. So what are we missing? What are the challenges? When we bring people in and we don't know what their needs are, maybe they can't communicate those needs to us. We do have challenges in that area. We use a client health record as well, which is a little bit more detailed, and try to gather all of that information as to what can be used and what we need to do, what pharmacy needs, what do we need to do to really serve these clients. And this information is confidential. We don't broadcast it across the shelter. Clients can trust that the American Red Cross is going to keep their information confidential unless they sign a release of confidential information, which allows us to share their information with our partners. And we think that's very important, and we encourage them to do that because it really helps in their recovery process, not only in the shelter setting, but long after when we're dealing possibly with FEMA or Small Business Administration or other relief organizations. So we do keep a comprehensive health record on the folks that really need it in our shelters. So challenges. These challenges are almost the same everywhere. Shelter workers are not always trained or able to meet the needs of the whole community. As I mentioned early on in this presentation, 93% of Red Cross workers are volunteers. It's a very diverse background, very diverse educational background. We have everybody with all sorts of skill sets in our shelters, and they're not always trained on how to deal with folks with functional and access needs or any other non-recognizable needs such as Alzheimer's or language barriers. We can always recognize those obvious needs. If somebody comes in a wheelchair, you can assume that there's some kind of need that they're going to have. My husband, I always use this as an example. He's blind, he's diabetic, he doesn't walk very far, he has a lot of needs. If somebody takes a look at him and doesn't take the time to talk to him, they're going to think he doesn't belong or maybe couldn't stay in a shelter. But the reality is he has all the equipment he needs. And if he has it with him, he can be very self-sufficient. So some of his needs are obvious, some of his needs are not so obvious. So we have to have those conversations. We also know that some clients can be perceived as difficult when in reality they're disoriented or they have language barriers. It's really amazing to me how even with a small child, your gut reaction is with a
Welcome, everyone, to the live Q&A portion of our program. My name is Nate Gardner, and I will be your host for this segment of the program. As usual, we ask you to use the chat feature located on the right-hand side of your screen. Please also address your chat to everyone if possible. After this short Q&A, we would like to ask each of you to answer the short evaluation questionnaire you will see on your screen. And I will now turn the the mic over to our speaker, to talk about a couple of case studies as a prelude to the Q&A session. And I see we already have some questions. Okay, Renee, the floor is yours.
All right, and I'll just let you know when we're ready to advance. First of all, I just want to welcome everyone. Glad to see you here. Our first case study is about a woman who arrives in an emergency shelter alone. She's not properly dressed for the season. She has no ID, no medications. She seems disoriented when she enters, and she seems to have trouble following group directions. I know you can read this, but she's approached by one of the volunteers who tries to get her to re-enter the registration line. She looks at him blankly. She doesn't seem to really understand, and she turns away from him. Go ahead and advance it, Nate. And the volunteer stands over and says, "Ma'am, are you all right? Do you have someone with you? Did you come alone? Are you sick? How can I help you?" And she seems to be overwhelmed. And when the volunteer reaches out and touches her on the arm, she pulls away and slaps at his hand. And she says to him, "I want to go home. My mother's waiting on me. She's worried. She doesn't know where I am. You can't keep me here. I have to go home now." So then the questions about that, and you can take them in either order, that I would like to hear your responses about this, is how do you reapproach her in order to gain her trust and her cooperation? And then also, how do you assess whether she's disoriented and whether she's cognitively oriented but just kind of distressed by the situation around her, or if she actually has some form of dementia? Thoughts on that? Okay, I'm not seeing anything coming up right now. I know we're throwing a whole lot of information at you very quickly. When you have someone like this, one of the things to look at is whether or you use those assessment tools, the ones that Janine had in her presentation, and you would need to reassess whether or not she is just simply disoriented because of the situation or whether or not she actually has some aspects of dementia. Because with someone like that, if she's in her 70s, she could have a 90-year-old mother at home that she's concerned about, or perhaps in another home that she's concerned about. So don't assume that she has dementia because she's in her 70s. So that's something that would need further assessment. As far as reapproaching, that volunteer would have to actually back off and leave her alone for a little while. Just keep an eye on her to make sure she stays in place and safe, but back off for a while and let her calm down, and then reapproach very slowly from the front. Do not touch her because she may not be able to tolerate it, or it may distress her more. Are there any comments or thoughts at this point? Janine, would you like to add to some of that?
Yeah, probably, you know, some of the coaching that we give our volunteers is exactly what you said, to back off and leave that person alone for a little bit. And when they do decide to reapproach on a more basic level, asking like things like, "Are you hungry?" Something that might draw them out to say, "You know what, I am hungry. And so, you know, can we get you something to eat?" Something on a more basic level, instead of trying to say, "Hey, you have to go do this right now." So that you start gaining that person's trust and they feel that, "You know what, if they're going to feed me, they must be nice." You know,
yeah,
that more basic instinct.
Yeah, that's a great point. That's a very good point. We've got a question here, or a couple of questions here. We'll hit these really fast and then we'll go back to the second case study. We've got a question about how to get a list of shelters in your area in an emergency. Janine, do you have a response for that?
Yeah, you probably won't get a list of shelters prior to, because we don't know what shelters are going to be opened, because it's dependent on every disaster is different. It's dependent on the case. But as soon as shelters are open, the Red Cross puts that word out immediately to the media and through emergency management. And that's typically how the word gets out, through radio. That's why we always tell everybody to have in their kit to have a battery-operated radio, because if there are no television stations accessible, that we try to get that word out. In some cases, you will find law enforcement or search and rescue going door to door, telling people where the shelters are and where they can go to be safe and to get fed. So that's just the typical procedure.
Right. Thank you so much. There's another question, but I'm going to hold it for whenever we go to the second case study, and then we'll go to just that last one about how do you handle a medical crisis within a shelter? And I think that's another Janine question.
We have trained medical responders from every level, from CNAs to nurses. Now, we don't always have all levels in the shelters. Our responders are trained basic first aid and CPR and how to recognize emergencies. If we have nurses or EMTs in the shelter, they can practice to the scope of their training, but as always, we would try to call 911. Now, when communications are out, I can see that might be a concern. We will have ham radio operators in our shelters that can communicate immediately with the emergency responders to get help to the shelter as quickly as possible.
Right. Janine, this is Arleen. When you are speaking about this, are you speaking about on most Red Cross shelters across the country versus any specific state?
No, we have disaster health services in Red Cross. That's one of the things that we have to have for our shelters, is some kind of health services. In smaller shelters, you will not probably find an RN there 24 hours a day, 7 days, you know, a week, unless we have people that warrant that. But every disaster relief operation and every shelter should have some form of medical personnel available, and that's nationwide.
Terrific. Great. Thank you. Great. All right. Now that we've kind of broken it up, let's go ahead and go on to the second case study. And this is about a gentleman who is 60 years old, enters a shelter, is identified as having some form of dementia. And at first he seems to be doing okay, but there's no family member with him. As he goes through the next couple of days, he begins to exhibit some behaviors that are troubling to other people. And he becomes suspicious and accusatory. He thinks other folks are stealing his belongings, attempts to go through other stuff looking for what he thinks are his own things, and yells at anybody who gets too close to his area. And he seems to get more agitated when the noise and activity level gets high in the shelter, and also when evening comes. And he's not medically frail, and he may not be able to be transferred to a special needs shelter. But the question that I have about that, first of all, I have what can be done to help improve the situation, but let's actually take a look at that second question. What interventions might help him in the evenings and when shelter noise and activity is high? Any ideas? I'll go ahead. Basically, whenever you've got someone like that, the noise becomes a distraction. It becomes a trigger for behaviors. And so what needs to happen is you need to be moved to a quieter part of the shelter. And I know that in some of the very small shelters, perhaps they may not have adequate places to put them in a quieter area. So then what do? It may be that you have to walk him around the block, if that's possible. If it's a situation where he can't go outside, you may have to move him off to a corner or an area where there's less activity going on. But also in my case presentation, I talked about having various activities available that would be appropriate for his age, his generation, in order to distract him and calm him. Something else to think about is with him being accusatory and trying to go through other people's stuff, is to give him a big tote box and have him put all of his stuff in there and encourage him to check it on a pretty regular basis. Maybe even write out a list for him of everything he brought, and he can check the stuff in the box against the list. And I know that for a lot of volunteers that may become time consuming, or it may be something that seems like it warrants that it's taking a lot of time, but in the long run it's going to take less time to do that than to deal with him being triggered by these various stimuli going on in the center. And the fact that he has dementia, I think the question we have here is, what's the process for deciding who is or is not able to stay in a general population shelter? And one of the questions here is about whether or not he would be able to stay in the shelter, in the general population shelter, or would he be more appropriate for a medical shelter? Janine, do you know that question about the process for deciding who is or is not able to stay in a general population shelter? Could you address that?
Yes, it's different. Everything is assessed on a case-by-case basis. And in my presentation, as I mentioned, every shelter is different and every community is different. So the resources available are hardly ever the same. So it would be a process of our Red Cross Health Services and our shelter manager, along with whoever the partners are in that particular community. It might be public health, it might be EMS, it might be a personal assessment team. What are the resources that are available for that person in that community? And if it's determined that there are resources available to provide a little more one-on-one attention for that person, and that would suffice to keep them in the general population shelter, then that would be a decision that could be made. If it was made that they needed to be relocated, then you have to start asking the questions, is there a medical shelter open? And if not, what is the alternative? Are there long-term care facilities that have beds available that are equipped to deal with someone in his situation? We certainly couldn't put him in a hotel room all by himself. That would be dangerous for him. It would not be a safe environment. So it's really a whole community response to what is the best possible scenario, because we do want to do whatever we can to keep people in general population. But again, the resources are all different, so it really is a conversation that has to be had at the time, and depending on how lucid this person is in involving them in the decisions that are being made on their behalf.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's important to give them a sense of feeling like they still have some control. And especially if you can't locate any family, then you do need to make sure that you try to involve him in some of that decision making, but probably on a limited basis because you don't want to overwhelm him. One of the other things is that even if he has been diagnosed, especially using the initial intake assessment, and you can tell that he's overwhelmed, disoriented, and that he's really having a tough time functioning. Now, that might not have been something that they picked up early on in the process, but I noticed on the initial intake that if it is life-threatening, to call 911. And so one of the issues might be that you have to keep an eye on this person, that he doesn't become threatening in that way towards other people. Because with the Alzheimer's Association, we have gotten calls from families who have said, just in a home situation, that they're being threatened physically, and we've had to have the caregiver removed from the home. And I imagine that in a stressful situation like a shelter, that could happen as well. For those of you who are listening in today, there are resources from your local Alzheimer's Association that can help you with some of this information. And I know that Janine and I have talked about that as well, to get even more training for the volunteers so that they can work with people like him. Because the personal care assistants are folks who hopefully will be able to be there in the shelters not just with people who have dementia, but with anybody with a medical issue. And I think the more training we can get for those people, then the smoother everything's going to go in that shelter setting. Are there any other comments or questions? Looks like we're on our final question. Oh, here we go. This is, are there shelters run by other organizations, and how different might they be from the Red Cross-run shelters? Let's see. Janine, that's a you question again.
Yeah, the shelters are run by other organizations, and that differs, again, from county to county, state to state. And that's okay. Are they all run like a Red Cross shelter? Not always. And that's something that we try to educate our partners on and emergency managers and let them know that there are special considerations when a church decides to open a shelter on their own. That's okay. But are they taking into consideration case studies like we just talked about, or the fact that there could be sexual predators in your shelters, unaccompanied minors? What are the liabilities that go along with those things? And those are considerations that they all have to take in when opening a shelter. So when it's not a Red Cross shelter, I'd like to think that across the country, we're all trying to play a part in at least educating our friends and partners who really want to do good things during a disaster on the realities of sheltering.
Great. One last thing, that's really good to know especially. One last thing I did want to mention, that for any of you who have someone who comes into a shelter and they may or seem to have dementia, look for a bracelet on their wrist or a necklace around their neck that is with for medic alert, safe return. It looks like the bracelets you get from the pharmacy that are for diabetics or people with heart disease, but the insignia on the front is purple. And on the back side, there's an ID number and an 800 number. And you can call the 800 number, and the medic alert safe return staff will have a database of all the people who are registered, and they can help you to reconnect that person with their family more quickly if they get separated. So that's a really great thing to look for. We strongly encourage our families here in Kentucky to have those. And we do have quite a few people who have them. And we have also had people recently who were reunited with their family within just a few hours because they did have the medical or safe return bracelet. And now this is a national program, though. So all the Alzheimer's Association chapters across the country do have this program as well. All you have to do is contact the association, and they can help you get started.
Excellent. I want to wish a big thank you to our speakers and also to our audience for your support and your feedback. Please fill out the short evaluation survey you will see on your screen. And as a reminder, our next webinar will be May 29th. The topic will be Predicting Alzheimer's Disease, Ethical and Legal Implications. Thank you again for attending, and this concludes our webinar for today.